In this video, we're looking at a kind of double Atwood machine. We have two pulleys that are glued to each other on axis. We're given the specs on those pulleys. One of them has a mass of 2.2 kilograms, a radius of 8 centimeters. That's glued onto the larger pulley with a mass of 6.5 kilograms and a radius of 17 centimeters. And we have string wrapped around these two pulleys in opposite directions. Mass is hanging off of those two strings. And we're going to release these things from rest. And ultimately what we want is to find the tensions in each of these strings as the system is accelerating, in addition to the angular acceleration of the pulleys. And the three parts of the problem are really just set up to walk us through the steps to get to where we're going. First, we're going to set up a system of equations, one for the linear motion of the first mass. I'll call this M1, that's the 1.5 kilogram mass. One for the linear motion of the second mass, M2. That's 0.9 kilograms, and then one for the angular motion of the combined pulleys. And we'll go ahead and label that total moment of inertia as I. And before we begin, it's actually really nice to figure out which way the system is going to accelerate. This isn't strictly necessary because if you guess the wrong direction, you'll just end up with a minus sign on your answer for alpha. But it is nice to know that all of our accelerations and our angular acceleration are going to be positive. So to figure out the actual direction of the acceleration when we release this thing, we have to imagine that we're holding the pulleys in place for a moment. So we're going to fix those pulleys in place and then analyze the torque exerted on the pulleys by these two different hanging masses. That will tell us which way this thing is actually going to start rotating. And then we'll go ahead and define the direction of positive acceleration for each of the masses and the angular acceleration for the pulleys. So if we're holding the thing in place and it's not allowed to accelerate, then the tension in each of these strings is just equal to the weight of the hanging masses. That is no longer true once everything is accelerating because the force is no longer balanced. But as long as everything is fixed in place, it is true. And we can write down a clockwise torque exerted by the 0.9 kilogram hanging mass. And that's going to be the tension in the string exerted through a lever arm equal to the radius of the large pulley. So the tension in the string is simply the weight of that mass. That's going to be 0.9 kilograms multiplied by G, and we're using 9.8 for G. And again, that force is exerted through a lever arm equal to the radius of the large pulley, which is 17 centimeters or 0.17 meters. And that clockwise torque comes out to about 1.5 newton meters. Then we compare to the counterclockwise torque exerted by T1. And T1 is going to be equal to the weight of the 1.5 kilogram mass. So that's just mg again, 1.5 times 9.8. And this tension is exerted through a lever arm equal to the radius of the small pulley, and that's 0.08 meters. This gives us a torque of about 1.2 newton meters. So we know right when we release this thing that the clockwise torque outweighs the counterclockwise torque. The entire system accelerates in this direction. In other words, the clockwise direction. So we're going to call that the positive direction for the analysis of alpha. And we can see the 0.9 kilogram mass is going to accelerate downward. So we'll use that as the positive direction for the analysis of the 0.9 kilogram mass. And the 1.5 kilogram mass is going to accelerate upward. So we'll use that as the positive direction for the analysis there. So this guarantees that A1 and A2 and alpha are all going to be positive numbers, and that just makes life a little bit easier. Now we get into writing down our system of equations. So first we'll analyze the forces and acceleration for M1, the 1.5 kilogram mass. That has a tension of T1 pulling upward. Again, that is no longer equal to the weight of the mass because the forces aren't balanced. This thing is accelerating. So that's an unknown. M1 also feels a downward force equal to its weight, and that's 1.5 kilograms times G, just mg for the weight of that. So there's the net force on M1, and that's equal to M1 times its acceleration. This is just F equals ma. So I have 1.5 A1, where again, A1 is upward. Now the analysis on M2, we're using the downward direction as positive there so that our acceleration comes out to a positive number. And the downward force on this 0.9 kilogram mass is just, again, mg, so 0.9 times 9.8. The upward force, that's the negative direction for this mass, that's T2. And that's all equal to ma for that mass, so 0.9 times a2, where a2 is that downward acceleration. The third equation is generated by looking at the torque on the combined pulleys. And we know that torque is equal to moment of inertia times angular acceleration. So that's where we're going to get our equation. Before I write this down, I need the total moment of inertia of those two pulleys that are glued together. So I'm going to do that as a separate calculation. So I is the combined moment of inertia of the two discs. And the equation for the moment of inertia of a disc is 1/2 mr squared. So symbolically, this is 1/2 little m little r squared plus a 1/2 big M big R squared. And we just plug in the mass of the small pulley, the radius of the small pulley, and so on. So the mass of the small pulley was 2.2 kilograms. Its radius, 8 centimeters, so 0.08 meters, and I have to square that. Add to that the moment of inertia of the large pulley. Its mass was 6.5 kilograms. Its radius, 17 centimeters, or 0.17 meters, and we have to square that. And we end up with a total moment of inertia of about 0.10097 kilogram meters squared. So now we generate an equation for the disks, and that's given by net torque equals I times alpha. The net torque is the clockwise torque minus the counterclockwise torque, because we know the clockwise torque is going to win, and we're trying to set everything up to be positive. So my clockwise torque is going to be T2, that's the tension in that string, multiplied by the lever arm here. That's the distance to the center of rotation, and that's big R. And the radius of that larger pulley is 0.17. All right, so there's our clockwise torque. And then we're counting the counterclockwise torque as negative. And that comes from T1, the tension in the string on the left, acting through a lever arm of little r. And the radius of that smaller pulley again is 0.08 meters. So we have a counterclockwise torque of T1 times 0.08. All right, there's our net torque. Then our moment of inertia was 0.10097. And alpha is the unknown angular acceleration of those combined disks. So now we have three equations, but we need to knock it down to just three unknowns. A1 and A2 are unknown linear accelerations. Alpha is the unknown angular acceleration. And what we need to do in part B is eliminate A1 and A2 in favor of alpha. And the relationship that relates that linear acceleration to the angular acceleration is A equals R alpha. This means that A1 is going to be little r times alpha, in other words, 0.08 times alpha, and A2 is going to be big R times alpha, 0.17 times alpha. So we make these substitutions into the equations for M1 and M2. And as I replace A1 with 0.08 alpha, I'm going to go ahead and multiply by the 1.5 out in front. And I get my first equation. That's T1 minus, and I'll go ahead and combine the 1.5 and 9.8. So T1 minus 14.7 is equal to 1.5 times 0.08 alpha. That comes out to a 0.12 alpha. Then our equation for M2, we'll go ahead and multiply 0.9 times 9.8. I get 8.82 minus T2 is equal to 0.9A2, but again, A2 is 0.17 times alpha. So 0.9 times 0.17 is 0.153 alpha. And finally, our third equation relating all the unknowns here is the equation for the net torque and angular acceleration of those combined disks. And I can write that as 0.17 T2 minus 0.08 T1 is equal to 0.10097 alpha. So now we're looking at a system of three equations and three unknowns. The unknowns are T1, T2, and alpha. And this is exactly what we're asked to solve for in part C. So the intent here was for you to just use your favorite utility, whether you're using the built-in functions in a TI calculator or Wolfram Alpha or some other computer algebra system. I'm going to use Maxima today. So we've input the three equations into Maxima, and I gave them the names EQN1, EQN2, and EQN3. Hopefully getting all the constants correct as I input these things. We're going to hit Shift Enter to assign all those names. And then we want to solve the system. And the syntax for this is to use the solve command. We put the list of equations in brackets, the list of variables we want to solve for in brackets. And Maxima may attempt to write things in terms of enormous fractions. So to stop that, we put the word float out in front. That gives us a decimal approximation. We end that line with a semicolon so we can see the output, and we hit Shift Enter. And there's our output for T1, T2, and alpha. We just need to round these to three significant digits. So we end up with final answers of T1 equal to 15.0 newtons, T2 equal to 8.46 newtons, and alpha equal to 2.37 radians per second squared. And there's one last thing I'd like to do just as a check on our work. We know the 1.5 kilogram mass should be accelerating upward, which means T1 better be larger than the weight of that mass. If we compute the weight of that mass real quick, M1g, we take 1.5 times 9.8, and we get 14.7 newtons. So the 15 newton tension pulling upward outweighs that and causes the acceleration to go up. So this is good. We'll do the same thing for M2. We take 0.9 times 9.8, and we get 8.82 newtons for the weight of that guy. The tension pulling up on it is 8.46 newtons, so the weight is larger than the tension pulling up, and the acceleration goes down as it should. Okay, and since I'm already in the mode of checking my work, we may as well do the final check on our work here, which is to compute the net torque on those combined pulleys based on those tensions, and then make sure it leads to the angular acceleration that we got from Maxima. So the clockwise torque is T2 multiplied by its lever arm, and that's 8.46 newtons. That's the tension for the string wrapped around the large pulley with a radius of 0.17 meters. Our counterclockwise torque was 15 newtons tension acting through a lever arm of 0.08 meters. And that net torque is supposed to be equal to I times alpha. Remember, I was 0.10097. And there's alpha. So let's just make sure alpha comes out correctly. We combine the numbers on the left-hand side and then divide by 0.10097. And when I run the numbers on this, I get that alpha is 2.36 radians per second squared. There's a slight discrepancy just due to some rounding differences, but now I have a high degree of confidence we've got everything correct in this problem. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. Or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.